Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. For a child will be born to us, a son will be given to us, and the government, it will rest on his shoulders, and his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Eternal Father, Prince of Peace. On the throne of David and over this kingdom, establish it, uphold it with justice and righteousness. From then on, forever, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will accompany this. Father, we do come. Isaiah chapter 9, many of you know, we have been going through the names of God as we got closer and closer to Christmas. The conversation among Linda and I and some others, are we going to do Advent this year? Now, I'm going to be honest with you. This will be the first year I have ever done Advent, and so I'm excited about it, and I hope you're excited about it. We've asked quite a few couples if they would come and read and then pray, and we need to realize that with all the commercialism that's just beating the tar out of us, it is okay to come to worship on a Sunday morning and be reminded that this is a holy, God-ordained season. It's not one that we look forward to just because there's time off work or just because there might be a present under the tree for us, but it's a holiday that reminds us that the most earth-shattering and important thing that ever took place in mankind happened that night when Jesus was crucified, when he was killed. Most importantly, though, when he was born. That night identifies the fact that the Lamb had been born, the Lamb had been given to us, but he was given for a purpose and a reason, to be sacrificed. Many of you know that earlier this year I was in Senegal, and there was a lot of things we were doing. I was responsible for a few, but one of the things I enjoyed most was we have a farm in Senegal out in the middle of nowhere. In fact, when you let the satellites go over it, you see nothing but brown, and you think that's not focusing on anything, and it's focusing on the brown Sahara, the desert. But then all of a sudden, out of nowhere, this little green box appears. And it's like they had missed something on the photo. The reality is this. There's hay and alfalfa and everything growing around that complex to take care of animals. And so we went and we took some lambs. And I remember the question I was asked by one of the church members there. He's one of the only ones that really spoke English. And he said, "Now tell me, what is the purpose of that lamb?" I'm going to say it again because it's a great question. He didn't know me. He knew we had come to bring some gifts and do some other things to teach animal husbandry. But what he wanted to know, there was a lamb there in that pen. And he said, "Why did you give us that lamb? What are we going to do with that lamb? What is the purpose of this lamb?" You know, there's a great question there when we think about the character of God. Again, in Isaiah chapter 9, we are told that we are going to receive the Lamb. But we also know when we let Scripture interpret Scripture and Scripture to interpret Scripture, we already know that that Lamb was coming for one and one reason only. And that's to be the payment for my sin penalty and your sin penalty. And as we begin Advent this season, I'm reminded that we need to ask ourselves, what was this lamb given to us for? Why did God love us enough to give us a lamb? Well, when we look into the name of the lamb, it helps us understand what the need in our life is. Commentators disagree in part on this passage in Luke chapter 9. Some of your translations will say, and I'll just, in verse 6 of chapter 9, "For a child will be born to us, a son will be given to us, and the government will rest on his shoulders." And his name will be called, and then in some translations it says wonderful, comma, counselor, comma. You need to understand that what people try to do is they try to completely dissect one characteristic of who God is, and we try to hang everything on that characteristic, and there, after that, there's no room for another characteristic of God, because all we've done is we've pre-assigned him, he's just my Savior, not my Lord. He's just my healer and not the great I am. We have to ask ourselves, what is the purpose of that lamb and why was the lamb given to us? Well, we do see this, that he was going to be called a wonderful counselor. During the week, I was kind of wrestling with the word wonderful. I had looked it up in the Greek and did some Latin homework on it. And then I was diving into the Hebrew a little bit. And I'm reading what everyone else has written, by the way. And I learned something about the word, the way it's used in Isaiah chapter 9. The word wonderful is used over and over and over again in the Bible, Old Testament, New Testament. But here in this circumstance, within the setting here, we need to understand that when we read the word wonderful, it is an incomprehensible trait. That's pretty good, y'all. Our God, our Savior, and the wisdom that he has is you cannot understand it. We have this earthly mind that's filled with all kinds of goofiness, and we think we have all the answers. And God reminds us periodically, and he says, I'm incomprehensible. You will never understand or figure me out. And we don't always like that, do we? We kind of like the idea that my God is, I've listened to some say this, he's kind of the gumball machine God. Well, what's that mean? You drop a quarter in the gumball machine, you turn it, and what drops out? I mean, that's God, and he's waiting on us to come to the gumball machine, drop a quarter in, pray a prayer, and then feel like we've been blessed. And that's not at all what wonderful counselor means. Wonderful counselor means that in our darkest moments, our scariest moments, when we are in the pit, we have been given a God that is so strong, he is so mighty, he cares for us and loves us in so many ways that we can't comprehend it, but yet we are called, and I beg you, when we get in those situations, we need to yield to that one we don't understand. We need to surrender to the one that we don't clearly understand, and that's God. During Bible college, I had the privilege of meeting a woman. There's been a couple of movies done about her and stuff, but I was in San Antonio, Texas, or just outside of San Antonio. Spring break had come around, and we were speaking at a church in Texas, and I was asked, and they mentioned her name, and I knew I should know the name, but I didn't know what for, and do you know who I'm talking about? And I said, man, I remember the name, but I don't know why, and he said, would you like to go meet her? I said, yeah, I guess. And we went to this unassuming little, probably 900 square foot, two-story white house with a white picket fence. And we walked up, and as we opened the gate, you could hear this African-American woman from inside hollering at the guy I was with, Tony, get in here! There's food on the table! I'm glad I just knew Tony at that point, all right? We went in and we had lunch, and she did not know we were coming, but something told her, I need to set an extra place at the table. And we got to go in and sit and visit with her. Miss Elizabeth was her name. And Tony looked over at Miss Elizabeth and said, Miss Elizabeth, he doesn't know why he's here today. And they started taunting me a little bit and toying with me a little bit. And she said, well, I guess I've got to show you, don't I? And I said, well, I'd like that. She said, come on, let's go upstairs. And I'm thinking, oh, Lord of mercy, what did I just commit to? Walked past, and again, a small little two-story house, but one little room, that's where her son was raised. Another one was where her two daughters were raised. But the next room we went into was all I could think of. It was just a really big, gutted-out hall closet. She opens the door, and it's dark as can be, and she reaches up and turns on that light. And that was her prayer closet. That was her prayer closet. I was frozen in my tracks. I didn't know what to say. I knew that I was standing in the presence of someone that was holy, that was anointed, and that I didn't understand and never would. So I needed to choose my words carefully and be very calculated. I said, "Miss Elizabeth, tell me, how long have you had this room?" She started thinking, and going on about 40 years, I guess. "How often are you up here?" Thought I said something funny. She laughed. She said, "Really, the question should be, when am I not up here? I went downstairs because God told me you all were coming and I needed to cook some lunch. But had you not drug me out of this closet, I'd be in this closet praying right now." Well, and all that prayer, all that investment you made, Miss Elizabeth, and setting time aside and praying for thousands upon thousands upon thousands to come to know Christ as their Savior, what is the one thing you've learned? And she thought for a moment, and she said, "I don't understand God." And that was it. I wanted to get her to give me some feedback, talk to me a little bit more, but her answer was emphatic. She understood it, and it was a testimony to her faith. What have you learned? I've learned I don't know God. I've learned I can't understand God. But I also have learned that every day I come into this closet and sit on that folding chair, God's waiting on me. God's waiting on me. We live, and you've heard me say multiple times, that I am and we live in a very frail, fractured, and flawed world. And yet, if it's not for the grace of God, we would remain hopeless in that state. But because this King of Kings and Lord of Lords came and he said, "How are we to know this guy?" Well, first off, he is going to be a wonderful counselor. He's going to be so out there, you can't even comprehend him. Church, we've got to stop acting like we understand God. I understand his love. I kind of understand his grace and mercy and forgiveness. But I cannot get into the heart or mind of God and dissect what he's doing all across the world, much less in my house. He is constantly at work doing and creating and if you will, plowing out a row that we can begin to plant the seeds of gospel in. We are in Advent. We're in Advent so we can take a few weeks and celebrate the fact that the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords left all the comfort and strength and security of heaven down to an earth that was filled with nothing but sin, to an earth that he knew would never understand him. And he came to that earth gladly. He lived his life sincerely. And he died on a cross for someone else. And that someone else is you and me. Man, Mitch, can you explain that? No. Because I know me. I know me. And is there enough to love and die for? Well, if you ask my wife and kids, they'd say yes. But the jury's still out on a couple of them. I want to let you know. But this Savior came to this earth, and he died on a sinner's cross in my place and in yours. God's known for a whole lot of things. But right now, he's known as a wonderful counselor. If your world is shattered, if it's confusing, if the fog of life is stealing the horizon and the sunset from you, then let's give it to God. Let's just yield it to God and say, "God, if you really are this wonderful counselor, then will I stop trying to have all the answers and yield to the one that does have the answers, and that God, that's you?" I'd love to pray with you. And there are others that if you come forward, they will join you here and meet you just to talk about what it means to know Christ. Or maybe to just pray with someone and seek reconciliation. Or rededicate your life to the wonderful counselor. Father, in the next few moments, have your will, have your way in our hearts, our lives, our families, and our church. I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together. As Linda leads us, you want to pray, you feel free to come. Linda, that might be the first time in my life I have ever read that last line on that hymn. Are you glad you came to church this morning?
Yeah.
Immediately following this, we're going to be across the street at the clubhouse having some just fellowship hour. That's what it is, juice, coffee, cookies. Also want you to mark your calendars for December 15th. It's going to be a busy day here in our campus. One, we're going to worship together. And then immediately following, we're going to have a town hall meeting at the church. And we do need you to sign up so we order the right amount of food. And we're just going to spend 20, 30 minutes just talking about the life of the church and where we're at and what is in our tomorrows. So make sure you sign up for that. But then don't forget that a few hours later at 5:30, we have 5:30, Linda, on the 15th, we have our Christmas musical here. So bring a friend to that. It's going to be a busy day. Sleep in a little later on Saturday to compensate for what you're going to lose on Sunday. Amen? Brother Yarbrough, will you close us in our prayer service?